From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Oh, hello. How are y'all doing? Thank you for being here. Does anybody have an empty seat next to them? Do you raise your hand if you have a seat that's empty, because we've got a couple people who are looking for seats. So just leave your hand up for a second. Empty seat, and then there's one over there who's got an empty seat. And over there. And I'm not gonna, and then there's a couple more over here. So empty seat hands, thank you. I worked for a long time at Disney World. I could do this all day. I am great at this. So my name's Kate DiCamillo, and before I get up here, you guys are always so nice. It's very, it does my wee little heart good. Story Pirates, do y'all know Story Pirates? They are gonna come up here and do a Mercy Watson extravaganza that I have never seen. And then after they're done, I'm gonna get up here and y'all are gonna ask me questions. Raise your hand if you think you have a question. Beautiful, because we'll just talk for like 30 minutes. And then I'm gonna go sign. And does anybody have any questions about the schedule for the rest of the day? I cannot answer them, but that's what I'm doing. Okay, so where's my Story Pirates guy? All right.
All right, thank you so much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, give it up one more time for Kate DiCamillo. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Gentlemen, I meant to say, my name is Branson. Can I get a hi, Branson? That's pretty good, but can I get a much louder hi, Branson? Good, good, that's the appropriate volume. All right, ladies and gentlemen. And you know what? I'm accompanied here today by On Keys. Can I get a nice big, hi, Jack?
Hello.
All right, so we both work for the Story Pirates. We're Story Pirates, and what Story Pirates do is we take stories and ideas written by kids just like you guys. I guess some of you adults too. We take stories and ideas from you guys, and we turn them into an amazing show. If that sounds like fun, can I get a oh yeah? Could I get an even louder oh yeah? All right, that's what I'm talking about. We're here today because we are so excited about it, and we love these books so much. We're here because we are such huge fans of Mercy Watson! Woo! Maybe a little repeat after me. When I say Mercy, you say Watson. Mercy! 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 All right, you guys are ready to go, I can tell. Now, I love the Mercy Watson books. Probably my favorite thing about the Mercy Watson books are that they're about a family. They're about a family. It's an unconventional family, but it's definitely a family. And I love that. I love that about the books. And it made me so excited that we could come here today. And the Story Pirates are going to do a show about family. That sounds like fun. Can I get a oh yeah? All right, here we go. Now, we are just about ready to start the show. But unfortunately, the actors for the show are not here right now. They're missing. I don't know where they are. So I would love to do the show. But unfortunately, I'm going to have to go home. This was nice. We had a nice, like, 2 minutes up here on stage, but goodbye, everyone. That's it. The Story Pirates
are gone. Wait, Branson! I'm here! I'm so sorry I'm late, Branson. Oh, my gosh, I'm so sorry. Oh, this is so my bad. I'm really, really sorry I'm late.
This is so your bad. Oh, guys, this is Katie. Can I get a hi, Katie?
Oh, hey, everyone. You guys, I'm so sorry I'm late, but oh, my gosh, I was at home before the show, and I decided, Katie, it's time for you to eat some breakfast. And so I got out my favorite thing to eat for breakfast, buttered toast. And I ate some buttered toast, and I had one slice of buttered toast. Uh-huh. And then I thought to myself, Katie, you know what I think would be nice? Another slice of buttered toast! So then I ate another slice of buttered toast, and I thought, Katie, maybe a third slice would be pretty good. So I had another slice, and then I was like, maybe four slices of buttered toast.
Katie, enough! Enough talk about the buttered toast! Look, it's great that you're here, and I'm glad that you had four slices of buttered toast, but we've got to get on with the show, okay? We've got to get on with the show, but unfortunately, we don't have enough people here. We only have two actors, really, so we can't do the show. So we're going to have to go home. Goodbye, everyone.
Okay. Bye.
Branson, I'm so sorry. This is extremely embarrassing. I am so sorry. I was late.
Whoa, hold the phone, guys. This is Tim. Can I get a hi, Tim?
Hi.
Hi, Tim.
Hello, hello.
Tim, why were you late?
I am so sorry. I woke up this morning and I was very, very thirsty. So I thought, how about some buttered toast? So I take some buttered toast and I put it in a cup. I tried to drink it, it was not working. I say, hey, let me try a different buttered toast. I put it in a blender, I blended it up, tried drinking it, it was not working. It took me about an hour before I just thought, I get a glass of water and pour it on top of the buttered toast. And that didn't work either. So then I started thinking,
Tim, stop!
Okay.
You tried to drink buttered toast?
Many times.
Oh, Tim, that's something I don't want to hear anything about. But
okay.
It's good news that you're here because one, two, three. Now we have enough story pirates to do a show.
Yeah!
All right, so let's jump right into this. What we're going to be doing for this show is we're going to be making up a story that has never been seen before. What? What am I talking about? How is that even possible? Let me explain it to you. What we're going to be doing is I'm going to be going around and I'm going to be taking ideas and suggestions from kids in the audience. So what's going to happen is I'm going to come around periodically. I'm going to be asking you guys for names of characters, names of places, all sorts of stuff like that. And I'm going to call on quiet hands to give me ideas and give these actors ideas for what we're going to do during the show. So let's just jump right into it. Let's start this story. But to start a story, I need a main character. I need a main character that I've never heard of before in my life. A brand new main character, entirely from your own imagination. What do we have? Yes.
A dancing polka-dotted pig.
That is what I'm talking about. We got a dancing polka-dotted pig who is going to be the first character of this story. But what I want to know is, what is the name? What is the name of this dancing polka-dotted pig who's going to be the first character of this story? Yes, right here. The name of this character is Egbert! Egbert the dancing polka-dotted pig. This is definitely a character I've never heard of before in my life. Egbert the dancing polka-dotted pig. But what I want to know is, what does Egbert the dancing polka-dotted pig want more than anything else in the world? What is it that Egbert the dancing polka-dotted pig wants? Yes. Egbert the dancing polka-dotted pig, more than anything else in the world, wants marshmallows. Let's see it.
Yeah, da, 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 da. Hey, oink, oink. Hey, everybody, my name is Egbert, and as you can probably tell, I'm a dancing polka-dotted pig. Hiya, hiya, ta-da. But the one thing that I want more than anything else in the entire world is a bunch of marshmallows.
Freeze. Wow, what a showman. I really like this character. But one character? That's not enough characters for a story. I want to meet a second character right about now. I want to know, who is the second character that we're about to meet in this story? Yes. We're going to meet a tap dancing octopus named, and one more time, what was that name?
Masella.
Masella? We're going to meet a tap dancing octopus named Masella. Really like this costume choice I'm seeing. Tap dancing octopus named Masella. But now what I want to know is, what does Masella want more than anything else in the world? What is it that Masella wants? I'm seeing. All right, everyone's telling me. What is it? What does this character want?
A friend.
This character wants a friend. Masella, the tap dancing octopus, wants a friend. Let's see that character.
Sorry, when you tap dance, you got to make sure to tap dance with each one of your legs. And I've got 8 legs because I'm an octopus. My name's Masella. I love to tap dance. It's hard with the suction cubes. They get in the way of the shoes. Oh, okay. It's sometimes hard because I need and want a friend.
Freeze. Wow, that's incredible. And suction cubes is the correct term. If anyone wants to fact check that, I'm sure suction cubes is what it's called. These two characters. All right, here's the thing though. This is going to be a story about family. So these two characters, they're in a family together. These two are related in some way. I would love to know from somebody in the audience, what is the relationship between these two? How are these two related to each other? How are these two related to each other? Yes. They both dance? Of course, they both dance. They're both tap dancers. But I want to know, how are these guys, so let's say that they're like in a family together, how are they related to each other? They're both animals, so it's like, is one like, are they like siblings or like a parent or a child? They're brother and sister. Very good. Thank you very much. They're both animals. They both tap dance. And they're brother and sister. But hold on. Wait a second. Hold the phone. Where does this story take place? What is the setting of this story? Where are we watching this story? I gotta know where it takes place. Yes.
Hawaii.
This story takes place in Hawaii. All right, let's see it.
Hey, Marcella, hey, come on, aloha, man.
Aloha, Egbert, just trying to make sure all my tentacles get this tap dancing on this sweet Hawaii beach.
Oh, yeah, those suction cubes make it pretty difficult, right?
You know, if someone could just tell me the word, I could use it correctly, but instead they just keep on making fun of me.
Suction cups, Marcella.
Well, this is news to me. Let me just write that down. Squeeze ink. There we go.
Hey, Marcella. Yeah. I know that you're my brother and everything, but guess what? I need to ask a favor of you.
Yeah, sure.
Look, I've been looking all my life for this one thing that I really want, which is marshmallows. Is there any way that we could get some marshmallows?
Sure. I've got plenty of time to help you get marshmallows because I don't have any friends to spend time with.
Oh, Marcella.
No, don't worry about it. It's fine.
No,
I'm fine.
No,
I'm fine.
I feel bad for you. I do.
Well, that's nice. You're a good sister. But let's focus on you right now. Let's get you those marshmallows.
Wow, do you have any ideas of where we could possibly find some marshmallows?
Freeze! What is the idea? What are they going to do? What is the idea that they're going to try to get some marshmallows? Yes, right here. They're going to try, it seems like a pretty good idea. They're going to try a cave filled with marshmallows. Let's see if they can find any marshmallows inside of a cave filled with marshmallows. Let's see it.
Being an octopus, I spent many a time in underwater caves, and methinks me have heard of a cave of marshmallows, methinks.
Ooh, wow, Marcella, let's go to that cave filled with marshmallows.
Strap on. Splash. Swim. Swim.
Whoa, Marcella, it's really deep and dark down here under the Hawaiian Ocean.
I know, I love it. Look, there's a cave. Let's go inside.
Freeze! But something was blocking the way. Something was stopping them from getting inside of this cave filled with marshmallows. What was the thing that was stopping them? Yes, all the losers. All right. Yes, what was the thing that was stopping them?
A woolly mammoth.
There was, unfortunately, a woolly mammoth. It was in their way. There was a woolly mammoth in their way. Let's see it, but let's give me 3 seconds.
Okay, before we go into this cave, I want you to be aware. There's many terrifying creatures in the water.
Whoa, Marcella, you didn't say anything about terrifying creatures. Oink, oink, before we left on this adventure.
Don't worry. There's only going to be creatures that are underwater creatures, which I know you're cool with. I know you as a pig are famously afraid of animals from the land, especially animals from the past.
Who goes there?
A woolly mammoth!
That's right, we're still around. We just live underwater now. And we guard caves.
Oh, no, Marcella, you're my brother and all, but guess what? I don't feel like you can protect me from this woolly mammoth.
Mr. Woolly Mammoth, all we want to do is go inside and see if there's any marshmallows. Is there anything we could do to get there?
Yeah, there's one thing you can do.
Freeze! What can they do? What can they do to get behind the woolly mammoth? What can they do? What can they do? Well, the woolly mammoth wants a dance show.
You guys are those tap dancing siblings, right?
You've heard of us?
Oh, a pig and an octopus? Yeah, I've heard of you guys.
Is it possible that maybe in exchange for a little dance show, you could let us into the marshmallow cave?
I'm not entirely unreasonable. It's very possible. All I need to see is a tap dance show from you guys. Right now, let's see it.
Okay. 5, 6, 7, 8.
Da 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 da
dance show. That was an incredible tap dance show. So yes, you can pass by me, and I hope nothing else blocks you from those marshmallows.
Wow, thank you. That's really, actually surprisingly kind of you.
And before you go, just a quick question. Like, if you ever want someone to hang out, like, play board games, or, you know, watch some TV, or even, like, draw?
Well, it's getting pretty late, so I'm gonna have to go. I'll see you later.
Of course, yeah, have fun.
All right, tell your friends. Woolly Mammoths, we're still around.
Yeah.
Yeah, he'll tell his friends.
Oh, does he not? All right, I'm out of here. Bye, guys.
Hey, Missella, it's okay. You know, that guy didn't seem like he was that cool anyway. You probably wouldn't want to be friends with him.
Be friends with him?
Right, yeah. So we're cool?
Yeah, sure. Let's work on your thing. We'll get some marshmallows.
Great, wow. Well, here we go. Into the cave. Oh. Wow. There are marshmallows everywhere. Okay. Do you think we could just take one?
I don't see why not.
Please! But as soon as they touch one of those marshmallows, something very surprising and unexpected happens. What is the thing that happens? Yes. Their hands get stuck to the marshmallows. Let's see it.
Ah, it's a normal day for me. My tentacle's getting stuck to something.
Hey, I don't know if this is completely normal, Marcella. Look, my hoof is attached to this marshmallow and...
Wait, usually I can take my tentacle off whenever I want, but now I can't.
Oh no, we're stuck! How are we ever gonna get unstuck?
Freeze! What are they gonna do? What are they gonna try to do to get themselves unstuck from this very sticky situation? All right, what is it that they are going to do?
Tell the woolly mammoth to come back.
All right, fan favorite, the woolly mammoth is going to return because they are going to tell the woolly mammoth to come back. All right, let's see that.
Hey, maybe we asked the woolly mammoth to come back. I mean, he seemed like a cool dude.
Okay, Marcella, yeah. You know what? I know you just want a friend, and I love you because you're my brother, but you're right. He's the only hope. Hey, woolly mammoth!
Yes?
Oh.
It's me, the beloved woolly mammoth.
Woolly mammoth, hey, we happen to have gotten stuck here on this marshmallow wall.
Oh, did you touch the marshmallows?
Yeah.
Should have warned you, don't touch the marshmallows.
That would have been a nice warning.
Would have been helpful.
Real sticky, yeah.
Well, what do we do to get unstuck?
Well, I know exactly what to do to get unstuck.
Freeze! What do they have to do to get unstuck from the marshmallow wall? Does someone have an idea? Do you have an idea of how they can become unstuck? Oh my gosh, this is the most amazing idea I've ever heard in my entire life. They are going to use their other hand to fire marshmallow tranquilizer darts at the marshmallows, which will make them unsticky. Let's see it.
So what you're supposed to do is, if your hand gets stuck to the marshmallow, use your other hand to throw marshmallow tranquilizer darts, which I assume you have.
Yeah, we
do. Good. Throw those at the marshmallow, and then it'll make the marshmallow fall asleep, and your hand will unstick from it.
Fall asleep?
Yeah, I can't explain it. It's just how it works.
Okay.
Okay, let's grab those marshmallow tranquilizer darts. I packed some in your backpack this morning.
Oh, why do you always pack for me? Let me be a big boy.
Hey, you know we gotta take care of family, right?
That's true.
Let's try.
Oh, the marshmallows are falling asleep.
Aww.
They're kind of cute when they're sleepy.
Oh, can we take one home with us?
Please, Mr. Woolly Mammoth, could we?
Freeze! Now, I don't know what happens next in this story, but I think you guys in the audience do know what happens next. So, using the hands is voting system, I want to know, does the Woolly Mammoth, hands down, if we think that the Woolly Mammoth does let them take the marshmallows home, raise a hand. Good. All right. Now, hands down. If we think that the Woolly Mammoth, however, doesn't let them take any marshmallows home, raise your hand. Ooh. All right. I'm seeing way more parents' hands on that one. All right. So, it looks like the Woolly Mammoth does. He is going to let them take the marshmallows home. Let's see it. Yeah, sure. Yeah, you can take those marshmallows home.
Wow! A brand new baby marshmallow.
They're beautiful.
Oh, wow. I can't believe it. I got my one true wish. I got some marshmallows. I have just never been happier in my whole life.
Freeze! And at that moment, This character was so happy that she decided to do something that she has never done before. She decided to sing a song about it. That's right, she's going to sing about how happy she is, and I know she's ready to do that. But I just want to give her one extra thing. I want to give her the title of this song. What is the title of this song that has never been seen before? A title of this song, yes. One more time, sorry. Happy Crazy Monkey. The title of this song is really good. It is Happy Crazy Marshmallows. Let's see it.
I've never been so happy in my life. I'm a dancing pig and I didn't know all the things I could have. I got a marshmallow from a cave, and my brother, he was so brave, taking us under the sea. Couldn't imagine what we could be. Brother, come in here.
I can't believe the marshmallow that were right there. I was so darn scared. And when I think about the fun I had, I can't wait to tell our parents and mom and dad. But I wish I could find a friend, or else my journey will never end. But for now I got a marshmallow and a sister on the side.
Hey, Woolly Mammoth, get in here!
All right. I don't know these guys very well. I let them in my cave, I thought that'd be swell. They made my marshmallows fall asleep. I said, that marshmallow, you're free to keep it. I don't know them that well, they seem nice. This one in particular, he needs a friend. But it won't be me. Goodbye, guys.
Bye, Woolly
Goodbye,
Mammoth.
Woolly Mammoth.
Bye, Woolly Mammoth. Thanks again.
I'm an elephant that's covered in fur.
Wow.
Wow.
What an amazing day we've had. We've got these marshmallows, and it just seems like everything's going my way.
Sure is. Heck, I guess at the end of a story, sometimes you don't get what you want.
Wait.
Freeze! Not so fast, because at the end of this story, he does potentially get what he wants. But it is going to ultimately depend on you and the audience. At this moment in the story, a brand new character showed up. I want to know, who is this new character, never before seen by human eyes? Who is this character, never before seen? Yes. That's okay. You want me to come back? Brand new character, never before seen. Yes. A cheetah? All right, a cheetah shows up. We're about to meet a cheetah, but I want to know, what is the name of this cheetah? Yes. Chubby Chicken the Cheetah? All right. He's named in honor of the late, great Chubby Checker. Chubby Chicken the Cheetah, with an onomatopoeia-style name, is about to show up. And he is going to potentially be a friend to this character. Well, we'll see. Let's see it.
Well, let's go back up to that beach in Hawaii. We got these marshmallows. There's nothing else we could find down here.
Okay, here we go. Let's swim to the surface.
Swim.
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 Swim. Swim.
Gasp!
Wow. Underwater, man. Things are weird down there.
Oh, yeah. That's why I come up here and live with a pig.
Okay, here we go. Land. Well, I guess I'll just take these marshmallows and put them in my backpack.
Zoom, hey! Sorry I'm late. It's very uncharacteristic for me. I'm a cheetah. My name is Chubby Chicken.
Oh. Well, pleased to meet you, Chubby Chicken.
Pleased to meet you.
Hey, Marcella, this is your chance.
What?
Get in there.
Hey, dude. What's up, man?
Oh, hey, how are you?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah,
sorry.
Are those suction cubes all over your arms?
Yes!
Yeah!
They're suction
cubes. That's what I call them.
Yeah, it's more fun and it flows more freely from the tongue.
Suction cubes?
Yeah.
I guess you could make an argument for that.
Please agree with me.
Sure, I do. I agree with you.
Hey, do you want to be my friend?
Well, I've never thought about it.
Freeze! You guys, wow, this is the moment we've all been waiting for. Does this cheetah want to be friends with Micella? Oh, what do you think right here? You guys, the cheetah does want to be friends with Micella. Let's see it.
Yeah, I'm going to stop you right there. I know the answer to this question. It's the same answer it always is. It's always no.
Wait.
Don't. You're going to try to let me down easy. It's just going
to
hurt.
No, I would like to be your friend.
Oh, wow. Really? You would like... Wait, what? What?
We have so much in common. We're both here in Hawaii. We both call them suction cubes. We both don't really look like the animals we're supposed to look like. We have so much in common. Why not be friends?
You know what? That's a pretty good sell. Let's be friends.
Let's be friends.
Wow. You know what? And they were so happy about becoming friends that they decided to sing one last song. Could someone please tell me what is the title of this song that's never been written before? Do you have an idea? Wow, you guys, this song sounds amazing. It is called Nice to Meet You, Dear Friend. Let's see it.
Nice to meet ya, dear friend. Nice to meet ya, cheetah buddy.
Nice to meet ya, dear friend. Nice to meet ya, you are an octopus.
One day we'll be strolling in the park side by side.
I'll be a little ahead, cause I'm a cheetah, it's a fact I cannot hide.
Hey, I'm an octopus, I got 8 legs.
I'm a pig and I got 4.
I'm a cheetah and I also have 4.
What a family day.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much. This has been an incredible story, and it was all because of the amazing ideas that you kids in the audience had. So, together at the end, I'm gonna count to 3, and on 3, I want us to all say the end together to end this amazing story. Here we go. 1, 2, 3.
The end.
The end. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We have been the Story Pirates. You have been an amazing audience. And now we're going to turn it back over to Kate DiCamillo. Woo!
Everybody, sorry to disappoint you. I am not Kate DiCamillo. I am Amy Joyce, and I am with the Washington Post, and I'm lucky enough to introduce Kate DiCamillo after those awesome story pirates with suction cubes. The Washington Post is very excited to be a charter member of this year's 15th Library of Congress Book Fest. Little bit of business if you are tweeting about the day. I'm sorry I have to tell you this. It is hashtag NatBookFest15. So Kate DiCamillo, I have a feeling that this will resound with a few of you in here. Kate DiCamillo has joined us a lot in our house this year. My boys and I might not live on Deckawoo Drive. Who knows Deckawoo Drive? Yeah, but we sure do like to visit there. And there are times at bedtime where we mysteriously suddenly crave toast with a great deal of butter. Sound familiar? Anybody? And much to my husband's chagrin, my children are now asking for a dog, preferably one who follows us home from the grocery store. He says no. Because you see, our house is like thousands of others. Its bedtimes are made richer by the words of Kate DiCamillo, this Newbery Award-winning author. And probably, like many others, I read these books with my children not just because they love them, but because I do too. And for this particular parent, these books remind me what it's like to be a child, and in turn, help me to be a mom. So today, we're lucky to have Kate DiCamillo, the perfect national ambassador for young people's literature, because she meets kids at their level with a respect and understanding that is illuminating. Her characters, like so many of her young readers, may start out seeming like just one little being, perhaps someone who started out sickly at birth, or maybe a cynical little girl, or maybe a child who feels alone in a new world without her mother. But they are all, of course, so much more. Just like in Kate's newest hit, Francine, Poulet meets the ghost Raccoon, where a formerly fearless animal control officer who once had a staring contest with a bear second one, actually struggles to face her one and only fear. So Kate is the reason, and I think, again, you all recognize this, that at bedtime we get this question, can we please just have one more chapter, Mom? And it's met on those up too late for a school night kind of evenings with an enthusiastic, I was hoping you would say that. Thank you, Kate. Let's cheer her on. And everybody ask lots of questions.
So, Amy, that was wonderful, thank you. And story parts, that was amazing. And I'm sitting there thinking, I don't want to get up on the stage after story parts because I can't sing and I can't dance. But I know they're not called suction cubes, so that's something. So, do y'all, we've got like a half an hour and we can do whatever we want with it. I'm hoping that y'all have questions, though, because that's what I like best is to like, for us to talk. So, and if you don't talk to me, then I will read to you for a solid 30 minutes. And it will probably be something that I wrote. So, who's got a question? Yes. I'm gonna come your way. Okay, you tell me, and then I'll shout it out to everybody else. Why did I start writing? Well, there's a long answer and there's a short answer. Which one do you want? She said short, but there were a lot of people shouting long over here. So I'm a big reader. As a kid who loved to read, I'm a reader as an adult, and in college I had a professor who said to me, this is a direct quote, you have a certain facility with words. You should consider graduate school. But I was like 20 years old when he said this to me, and I didn't think that he was really telling me to go to graduate school. I thought that he was trying to tell me in some kind of teacherly code that I was wildly talented and that I was going to be a rich and famous writer. So I thought, why bother with graduate school? This is the long answer, by the way, right? So I don't go to graduate school. Instead, what I do is I get some black turtlenecks, because that's what writers wear. And so I got the black turtlenecks. I wore them all the time. I sat around looking bored and disdainful, and people would go, that's Kate. She writes, you know? And so I managed to do that for a solid 10 years. And telling everybody that I was a writer and reading books on writing and dreaming about being a writer and wearing my black turtlenecks. And then right before I turned 30, it occurred to me that if I wanted to be a writer, I was gonna have to write something. So I started to write at 30, and I started by writing 2 pages a day, and that's what I still do. And that's why I write, because I waited so long and spent so much time not writing. And now that I've started, I don't intend to stop. So, yes, right here, please. Yes. What was my first book? My first book was Because of Winn-Dixie. Do y'all know that story? That makes me happy. So, I wrote that book. I started writing. And pretty soon after I started writing, I grew up in Central Florida, and I moved to Minneapolis. Anybody ever been to Minnesota? Yeah. So it was a shock to the system, let's just say that. And I wrote Because of Winn-Dixie during the second winter that I was there, which was up to that point the worst winter on record. And I was homesick for Florida, and that's where Winn-Dixie takes place. And also, it was the first time in my life I'd been without a dog. How many of y'all have dogs? That's so good. Any cat owners? Right. So anyway, I couldn't have a dog, but I made up the best dog that I could think of, and that was the first book, Because of Winn-Dixie. Right there, yes. My favorite book as a kid? Boy, I was a kid who just, I read so much and so many different books, and I say I read without discretion. If it was a book, I loved it. But there were a couple that I came back to quite a bit. One of them was a biography of George Washington Carver that I checked out from the library so often and accumulated so many overdue finds with that my mother asked the librarian if she couldn't just buy it. And I remember the librarian saying to my mother, "You know it doesn't work that way, Betty." So that was one of my favorite books, that biography, and I can't remember who wrote it. I loved Stuart Little. How many of y'all have read Stuart Little? And this is a really sad story, but I didn't read Charlotte's Web when I was a kid because, anybody know the story Black Beauty? I read Black Beauty, and I could not believe how that horse suffered. And so from that point on, I would not check out any book that had an animal on the cover. And there was Wilbur, the pig, staring at me every week, and he looked really worried. And I thought, something terrible is going to happen to that pig. I'm not having anything to do with it. So I didn't read Charlotte's Web until I was 30 years old. But I would put that up there as one of the best books and one of my favorite books, even though I came to it late. Yes. My favorite part about writing, there's a great quote from Dorothy Parker. You've probably never heard of her. Have you heard of her? I didn't think so. So there's a great quote from Dorothy Parker, which is, "I hate writing. I love having written." So my favorite part about writing is that I wrote. You think about that for a while. In about 15 years, it'll make some sense to you. Writing is really, really hard for me, and it's always something that I have to make myself to do, and then I'm really glad that I did. And then another favorite part of writing is like seeing the finished book, which is amazing, or getting a letter from a kid. This is the most amazing thing in the world, saying, "I hated to read, and then I read because of Winn-Dixie, and I like to read." So that's another great part about writing. Yes. How many books have I written? I think I've got 19 out there now. And do you think that's a lot or a little? Do you feel like I've been lazy? Because you looked kind of disappointed. So 19 and a novel on the way. And how many of y'all know Francine Poulet, the animal catcher? Yeah, so that one is out there now. And then if you know Baby Lincoln, who from Deckawoo Drive, she's going to have her own book next, and then a novel comes out in April. Yes? My favorite book that I wrote. Are you an only child? She's an only child. So what I normally say at this juncture is, "Are you an only child?" And people usually helpfully say that they're not. And then I say to their parent, "Which child do you like the best?" But we know which child your parents like the best. The books feel like my kids to me. And so I can't pick a favorite because I love them equally but differently. I see them as deeply flawed but lovable anyway. You're an only child, so you're not deeply flawed. Yes. How long does it take to make a book? It actually takes me quite a long time. So it takes me about a year to a year and a half to write the book. And then after that, a lot of other people come in and help me. There's the editor who helps me to rewrite it. And then there's the design team to make it look like a book, and then it needs to get printed. So from the time I start, from the time I put down the first word until the time that you hold the book, it's usually something like 3 years, something like that. It's a job for patient people. Yes. How did I come up with the storyline for Flora and Ulysses? Do y'all know Flora and Ulysses? Which is a really hard book to talk about if you don't know it, because it's like, how do you explain the story of a squirrel who gets sucked into a vacuum cleaner? People start looking at you like, wow, and walking away. So anyway, where did that come from? It's another long story. So My mother passed away in 2009. My mother had a vacuum cleaner that she loved, an Electrolux, a Tank Electrolux. Somebody's going to go, ooh, I have a Tank Electrolux. Raise your hand if you know that vacuum cleaner. My mother thought that the sun rose and set over this vacuum cleaner. And in the last year of her life, she would say to me, what's going to happen to the vacuum cleaner after I'm gone? And I would always say, I'll take the vacuum cleaner. Don't worry about the vacuum cleaner. So my mother passed away, and I did as I promised I would do. I took the vacuum cleaner. But the thing is that my mother had a cat, the world's most evil cat. Her name was Mildew, and I am allergic to cats. And so when I got the vacuum cleaner, it was filled with mildew hair and dander, and I couldn't bring it into the house, so I put it in the garage. Are you with me? Okay, so the vacuum cleaner's in the garage. Every time I pull into the garage, I see the vacuum cleaner, and it makes me sad. It makes me miss my mother. So that's part one of where the story came from, the vacuum cleaner. Part two is the spring after my mother died, there was a squirrel on the front steps of my house, and he was obviously clearly dying, and I didn't know what to do for him. And I called one of my best friends, whose name is Carla, and who has asked me not to say her name anymore when I tell this story, because I didn't know what to do. She really is the gentlest and kindest of all of my friends. I said, there's a squirrel dying on the front steps. I don't know what to do. She said, do you have a shovel? I said, yeah, I've got a shovel. She said, get the shovel, get an old t-shirt. I will come over there and whack him over the head. Direct quote. So I'm on the cell phone, very close to the squirrel when she says this, and I start backing up because I don't want the squirrel to hear those bloody words she just spoke. And I go around in the side door into the house, and when I look out at the front window, guess what? The squirrel's gone. He did hear her, and he thought, no, not me. I'm gonna die some other way. And so he left, but I have this squirrel in my head, and I start thinking, in the immortal words of E.B. White, he said he started to think about how to save a pig's life. I started to think about, how can I save a squirrel's life? And there's that vacuum cleaner sitting in the garage. And I put those two things together, and that's where I got the idea. There, okay. Yes. Do I have any tips for future writers? Because this person, what's your name? Ruby? Ruby is writing a book. How many of y'all are writing a book? You can tell the truth, because I know there's some adults. I'm writing a book. So what are the tips that I have? The tips are relatively simple. One, you need to read as much as you can and in as many different kinds of books as you can. Do you like to read? Okay, excellent. I can't imagine somebody who wants to write a book that doesn't love to read, but I've met some of those people. So read as much as you can, and then find some way to make a deal with yourself about how you're going to do the work of writing, because it is work. For me, it's those 2 pages a day. That was the deal that I made with myself a long time ago. It's easy to get 2 pages a day done when you get home from school, or before you go to school, or when you get home from work, or before you go to bed at night. So just make a deal about doing the work. And then keep a notebook. Do you have a writer's notebook? I have a notebook with me all the time. I eavesdrop on people. Do you know what that is? It's not polite. Right, you're listening to people talking or doing stuff. It's astonishing what people will say to each other. Write it down. You could turn it into a story. So, and also I have that notebook because if I'm not listening to people, I'm looking at the world and I see things that I think might turn into stories. And the last piece of advice I have is not to give up. You have to be relatively persistent if you want to be a writer. There's going to be a lot of rejection. When I go into schools and talk to kids, I have a PowerPoint presentation where I talk about how many rejection letters I got. Do you want to guess how many I got? 10. Not 10. Not 1,000. Not 20. 470-something rejection letters. So I got a lot of no's before I got a yes. So you've got to kind of brace yourself for that. It doesn't happen right away. Okay. Yes. Right, this is the irony. So I said that when I was little after Black Beauty, I didn't want any book with an animal on the cover. I wouldn't read anything that I have written. The child me would not pick up one of my books, you know, because every one of them has got an animal on the cover. Yes. How did I come up with the idea of a superhero who has one of his powers is poetry? Seems to me that poetry doesn't get enough attention, right? And to me, poetry is a superhero. To have a superhero that like can say the right thing at the right time and that loves words. Words can do such amazing work in the world. And so I didn't do it on purpose. It just seemed funny to me to have a squirrel that liked poetry. But then I started to think, yeah, I believe in poetry and that it can be a superpower. So how many of y'all like poetry? I came late to poetry. Do you know Garrison Keillor's collections of good poems for hard times? That's a great place to start if you don't know poetry. Hey, I wonder how I'm doing time-wise. Iris? Okay, good. I saw you look at your watch. You weren't even paying any attention to me. She's like, what time? Yeah, okay. All right, good. Yes. Why did I decide to start writing children's books? So when I finally started writing, I didn't start by writing books for kids. I started by writing short stories for adults. I thought they're short, therefore they must be easier. That's not true. But what happened to me was I was writing those stories and sending them out, and then I got a job at a book warehouse, and I was assigned to the third floor, which was all kids' books. And my job there was I was a picker. I went around picking books off the shelves. And as a reader, it was only a certain amount of time before I started reading those books that I was picking. And the first book for kids that I read that had been published since I was a kid was The Watsons Go to Birmingham 1963. Do y'all know that book? Raise your hand. If you don't know it, go and check it out from your library. It's amazing. I read that book. It was so funny, and it talked about really big things, so it was a serious and funny book, and I thought, I want to do something like this. So that's when I started trying to write for kids, was because of that book. And Bridge to Terabithia. Do y'all know Bridge to Terabithia? Yes. What was my inspiration for Edward Tulane? So do y'all know the story of Edward Tulane, a vain rabbit? I got from a friend a rabbit doll as a gift. And he comes up to about here on me. He's big. He's dressed in this very elegant outfit. And when she handed him to me, I said, what's his name? And she said, Edward. And I said, thank you very much. And I took him home, and I put him on the couch in my living room. And every time I walked into the living room, I screamed because he's a really creepy-looking rabbit, you know? And he was sitting there like this. And then, like, the third night that I had him in the house, I had a dream about him. And in the dream, the rabbit didn't have any clothing on. It's your basic naked rabbit dream. And I think all writers have them, and not everybody admits it. I'll admit it. I have naked rabbit dreams. And I thought, that's a great place to start a story. And I thought it would be a picture book about a lost toy. But when I sat down to write, it just kind of unspooled in front of me. It became much bigger than I imagined, and I wasn't telling the story. The story was telling me, so it just kind of wrote itself. And usually for me, a novel takes 8 or 9 drafts. That one took 4, and I thought, wow, now I've really figured out how to write. I'm in business now, but that was just that one. Now I'm, you know, back to 8 or 9 drafts. It just told itself. So the story was a gift. Yes. My favorite author? Just one? Who's your favorite author? J.K. Rowling is a good choice, I have to say. If you made me pick just one, probably E.B. White, because in addition to Charlotte's Web and Stuart Little, he wrote amazing essays, and even his letters are incredible. It's a really big book, though. It'll be a while before you read his collected letters. Yes. Wow. Okay, so first grade?
Kindergarten.
Okay, so in kindergarten, and you read all six Mercy Watsons through the year. And this year's class is fixated on last year's class, because this year is just hasn't started to, yeah. School already started in Minnesota. Yeah, so they were fixated on Eugenia Lincoln and why she's so unhappy. It's really a wonderful question, and I do answer it in the book about Eugenia when she gets her own story. Yeah, so bless their little empathetic hearts, because this is the thing, is like when somebody is so clearly unhappy, there must be a reason. Oh, they worried about Eugenia, and if she got a Valentine's card, maybe it would like make her happier. Tell them they're writing stories. Yeah, that's what they're doing, and thank you for reading to them. How many teachers in the audience? Thank you, you guys. How many of you read out loud to your class? Bless you. I know there's not time to do it, and you make time to do it, and it matters so much. I was a kid who was read to at home and got taken to the library, and I still lived for Mrs. Boyette to read to us every day after lunch. Island of the Blue Dolphins. How many of y'all know Island of the Blue Dolphins? It you impact kids' lives in ways that you just have no idea by reading, so thank you. Yes. What inspired me to write Mercy Watson? So I had this idea that Mercy Watson was a pig, and that she lived with Mr. and Mrs. Watson, and they weren't pigs, and they had lost sight of the fact that she was a pig. And that all seemed very funny to me, but it was an idea that I kept on playing around with, and I couldn't quite make it work. And so I put it away, and then I would take it back out, and then I would put it away and take it back out. And then finally what happened was I got a new car. And it was my first brand new car. I mean, never owned by anybody else. It was a Mini. It was super cute. And on the very first day that I had it, I took a friend to the airport, and she got into my brand new car with a gigantic piece of toast. And thank you. And started to eat the toast, spraying greasy crumbs all over my brand new car. And so I said to her, don't do that. Wait until you get to the airport to eat your buttery toast. And instead of that stopping her, she continued to eat the toast while lecturing me about toast and how it was better if somebody else had made it for you, and that the butter should be spread all the way to the edges, and that there should be a great deal of butter on it. And by the time I got rid of her, I knew what was missing in the book about the pig, which was what the pig loved, which is toast with a great deal of butter on it. So that's, and once I had that, then the stories kind of wrote themselves, because Mercy is one of those characters where you put her in a situation and then you just get out of the way and watch her make havoc out of it. When you write books for kids, people always say, what lesson did you mean to impart here? And those books are the answer, nothing. No one ever learns anything in those books, you know? And so it's just, I don't know, maybe adult writers get asked that question about lessons, but you know, a story is a story, right? Yes. It's a scary question, but I'm going to repeat it anyway. Have I ever had writer's block? And if I have, what did I do to overcome it? So here's my official position on writer's block, is that it doesn't exist. They're just bad writing days, right? That's what I tell myself. So sometimes you can have like bad writing days that last for like weeks and months, but you just call it a bad writing day, because no matter how bad things are, I can make myself write two pages. It might be really lousy, but I still make myself do it, because what I've found over time is I never know when something's gonna shift and when the story will open up, or when the thing that I'm working on that's not working will give me the idea for the thing that will work. So my policy is just to keep on showing up and doing little incremental pieces of lousy work until something good might come along. Does that make sense? But that's kind of like the way I am with everything. I just break it down into small, manageable things. Big concepts scare me. Yes. When I was a kid, what was the first thing that I ever read? Oh, wrote. The first thing that I ever read was Little Bear. Do you guys know it's like, oh my God, I can read. I was like the most amazing thing in the world. But the first thing that I wrote, I didn't write very much when I was a kid. You kids, how many of the kids in the audience have seen a writer come into the schools? You've gone to a bookstore and seen a writer, or I'd never met a writer, and I loved books so much that I didn't think they had anything to do with human beings. So I didn't know who was making them, but I didn't think it was people. So I never really thought about being a writer, nor did I write anything myself, except just some really deeply felt, truly bad poetry that I wrote to the dog. And oddly, my mother did hang on to that and hauled it out when I got published 4,000 years later and said, look, she wrote some really bad poetry to the dog. Yep, you've got a striped shirt on.
Is it really a town called Naomi, Florida?
Is there really a town, Naomi, Florida? There is, to the best of my knowledge, because it was before Google, there is not a Naomi, Florida. Does anybody know any different? I don't think there's a Naomi, Florida. I haven't Googled it, but it's astonishing. Remember, raise your hand if you remember the world before Google, when you could find the answer. You know, it's just like, and now you think, well, I'll find the answer to that right away. And Google had just kind of started when I was writing Despereaux, and I remember like typing in the name Despereaux, and absolutely nothing came up. And I was like, good, because I didn't know where I came up with that name, and I was afraid that I'd taken it from somewhere. Yes. Where did I get the idea for Tale of Despereaux? So Winn-Dixie had just been published, and I was visiting my best friend, and her son was 8 years old at the time, and he had never been very impressed with me before, but he was a big reader, and all of a sudden, here I was with my name on a book. So that whole visit, he followed me everywhere I went, and at the end of the visit, he asked if he could have a private word with me in his room. And so we went into his room, and he closed the door, asked me to take a seat, and then told me that he had an excellent idea for a book. I'm like, all right, what is it? He said, it's the story of an unlikely hero with exceptionally large ears. I'm like, great, what happens to the hero? And he said, well, I don't know. That's why I want you to write the book. And so he did not say mouse, but I thought the phrase unlikely hero was just laden with possibilities. And so I started there and got to a mouse. And then eventually by the time the book was published and then it won the Newbery, by that time Luke was 14 years old, and I made him go to that banquet and wear a tie and stand up in front of 1,000 people, and he was not happy. Because everybody always goes, oh, he must have been so happy when that... No, he wasn't happy. But now he's totally grown up, and he's a teacher, and guess what? A writer. So, yeah. Oh, there it is. Okay, 10 minutes. All right, 10 minutes. Yes, I want to get some more of you adults, too. Yes. So the question is, do I intend to do any more books with Despereaux or Winn-Dixie, any kind of sequels? It's a very sequel-y kind of world now, isn't it? And I remember pretty soon after Winn-Dixie came out, and I saved this letter for a long time, and I don't have it anymore. I lost it in a move. It was a 10-page letter from a kid in Illinois telling me what was going to happen in Winn-Dixie 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And what I remember, I don't remember any of his ideas, but I remember the P.S. he squeezed on the last page, which was, I have done all of the hard work. Get busy. That's what he said. That kid is an adult now somewhere. He's probably a lawyer. But I've never really felt the pull towards a sequel with, I felt like with Winn-Dixie, those characters, I left them in a safe place. And the same with Despereaux. It's just like, I don't think so. But I never know when something is going to open up. So I wouldn't say no. And one time, I was a long time ago, I was doing a signing, and somebody asked for a sequel to Edward Tulane, and I said, no, I know that won't happen. But then a kid came up to me later on, and he said, but what about Bryce? Don't you think he needs a book? And that has stuck with me, and I've thought about it. So I might come at it sideways from, you know, I would like to write a book about Bryce. But so, yes. How did I get the idea from Migory Sal? Migory Sal is one of those, she's a character in Tale of Despereaux, kind of a heartbreaking character. How did I get the idea for her? I don't know. She showed up. And this goes back to that thing where you're having bad writing days and you think I'm just going to give up. But then you come down one morning and you turn on the computer and a character shows up who you did not anticipate showing up at all. And so that's the beauty of, like, just relentlessly working on something, is that characters will find you sometimes. I never feel like I make up the characters. I feel like the characters are real and I've discovered them. I don't want to ignore this side of the room. Did anybody? Yes. Yes. The question is, how do I choose the characters in my books? It's more like the characters choose me. So that little notebook that I have that I carry around with me, sometimes characters will pop into my head, their names will. I'll jot them down in the book, and then I'll carry them around, and when I'm looking for the next thing to work on, I'll take out that character name and see if it seems right for a story. So I'm always just kind of like carrying the people around with me. Yes. Are any of my characters based on people that I know? And do you have lawyers in the family? Teacher, yeah. No, they're not. And it's funny, I have yet to do that. I mean, it's from knowing people and loving people. That's where the characters come from. But I have not based anybody on anybody I know. Although somebody wrote me a letter not too long ago saying that their grandmother was named Mercy Watson, and she was a librarian. It's like, wow, I hope she had a sense of humor. Yes. Why do Bink and Golly like to roller skate? Do y'all know Bink and Golly? So Bink is the short one and Golly is the tall one. Do you think I look a little bit like Bink? Yeah, a little bit. So why do they like to roller skate? Because I loved to roller skate, and I grew up in a time before, roller blades. So we had the old fashioned roller skates, and I loved roller skating, and I fell down quite a bit. I wasn't any good at it, but I was enthusiastic nonetheless. That's the way I approach everything. Okay, we've got time for two more questions, and you look so desperate that I'm going to pick you. Yeah. How else do I get inspired to write a other than reading books? And you know what? Reading books does give me a lot of inspiration. So it's not like you get ideas from other books, but they feed you in a certain way, and they teach you how to look at the world. The rest of the inspiration comes from the world and being in the world. And that thing about listening to people when they talk, sometimes eavesdropping, sometimes not. And just paying attention to everything in the world. Sometimes people go, aren't you worried that you're going to run out of things to write about? And I always say, have you been on a city bus recently? Because really, if you get on a bus, which I do sometimes with a notebook, just to ride around and listen to people and look at them, you see there is not enough time in the world to write all the stories that are out there. I now have 2 minutes left, says Iris, and she is not messing around. So that means we have one more question, and whoever asks this last question, okay, you look enthusiastic, but I have to tell you, you have to sum up everything that we've talked about and, like, move the conversation forward some. Okay, good. You don't look intimidated by that. All right. Oh, you're a good aunt. Well, you're a librarian. I love you librarians. So she's got a 7-year-old niece who loves Bengali. There are 3 Bengalis. The 7-year-old niece wants to know where the 4th one is. I don't know that there, do you remember how, raise your hand if you remember Mary Tyler Moore. Remember the group hug at the end of Mary Tyler Moore and how grateful you were to them for going out before it became like, just a really bad show. It stayed a great show. They had a group hug and it was over with. I feel like those things, those stories worked out just right, and to do more might be a mistake, you know? And so tell her I'm sorry, but that I'm walking around looking like Bink all the time, if that cheers her up any. Yeah. And that I love peanut butter. Does she love peanut butter? Yeah. That's all that's in my refrigerator, peanut butter. Okay, see, that did move the conversation forward, right, into food. And I'm going to sign somewhere. I don't know where, but I bet y'all know where. And I just want to say thank you for being here today. Thank you for reading. Thank you for reading to your kids. And thank you for believing in the power of books. So have a good time here today.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.